Good morning, good morning, good morning, everybody, and welcome to our family-friendly session on this very cold morning in South Africa. Thank you so much for joining us all while we collectively immerse ourselves in these sessions to learn more about how we can survive this pandemic, how we can survive this very difficult time that we are all going through in one way or another. I hope you can all hear me. If you can't, just let me know. So our session today is really about digging deep to dig ourselves out. The COVID third wave has happened, particularly in Gauteng. Just as we thought that COVID would bring brighter days with the vaccines coming on board, it's just continued to be very challenging for all of us. Some of us have been sick, some of us are sick. A lot of us have lost loved ones, and we find ourselves in this never-ending grieving period. The unrests came last week very abruptly and took us all by surprise. Unemployment is so real. I'm sure all of us know someone who's unemployed currently, and it affects us, and it affects our household income and so on and so forth. The list is endless. Today really is about how do we keep our heads above the waters and find meaning in these times. Someone who's done a very significant work over the past years, and also particularly since COVID hit, is clinical psychologist Judith Anser. We're very happy to have her with us here today. And very big thank you to our Dean, John Foster Pedley, for ensuring that we prioritize and have this session with Judith in particular, because she's done such significant work around this. She's the founder and member of the Health Workers Care Network, offering volunteer psychological support to healthcare workers. Since the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, she has an interest and a big heart in helping others to tolerate the imperfection and uncertainty, and to understand that we can survive discomfort, the discomfort that these current times have generated. And just she's going to help us find ways to learn more about ourselves, how we can cope with what's happening in the external environment, and how we can strive to be better in this time. But before I hand over to her, I'd like to just ask Dean and Director John Foster Pedley to say a few words about the importance of the session today, how the school is supporting all our students, all our alumni, all our faculty, staff, everybody that's in the Henley ecosystem to really survive these trying times, and how the school is seriously supporting everybody through this difficult time. So John, over to you, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Mamo. Hi, Judith. You've been well introduced by Mamo. That's a great introduction. There's still a couple of people coming in, so I won't take up much time, because you really need to spend time with Judith, who I know well and is exceptional at what she does. I think there's lots of things that challenge us anyway in life, but the sort of world we live in at the moment, with the amount of COVID we have, and as Mamo has said, I'm really sorry, and our condolences to those of you who've lost people, and strength to those of you who are going through this as well with the COVID. Luckily, the peak is diminishing now in most parts of the country. And of course, we have the other challenges. And on top of that, we have our work, and we're probably doing MBAs or other courses, and then we have our families to look after. And so we have to dig and find some resilience in all this. And it's all very well to do that in a sort of artificial way, like pretend to have a big smile on your face. But the deep reality is that by sharing and listening and hearing and understanding everyone else's lived realities, we're all the same. We all live pretty much the same sort of challenges in our life in many respects. And there is no significant difference, really, And so at Henley, what we want to do is not only build people who take programs, but we our motto is we build the people who build the businesses that build Africa. So our ambition is to build a prosperous Africa. And you're the people going to do those. And none of us can do that by pretending we're not human. And learning how to handle and gain those human strengths and skills that are going to allow us to be resilient. So I'm really on board with this. I should be listening as much as I can. And I'm going to hand over to Judith. And I hope you really enjoy this. And what I would say, just chill and be yourselves. And there's no performance requirements here other than just attention. Thank you very much indeed. Over to you, Judith.
Thank you very much. I'm going to share my screen now. And thank you for a very warm welcome on a very cold day. I believe it's even cold in Durban, that somebody based in Durban is wearing a beanie, Mama. I mean, it's got to say something. So I'm a clinical psychologist by training. And so our work is always about how do we help people cope? How do we help them be more functional? And what I've been struck by is with everything that's going on, we feel often like we're in a really deep hole. And the paradox, of course, is that sometimes when you're in a deep hole, in order to get out of it, you have to dig deeper. You have to understand more. You have to think about what's going on inside of ourselves. And we have to think about what's going on in the upstairs parts of our brain and what I'm going to tell you about the downstairs parts. And none of this is simple because, as you know, we are all in the cliche of the pandemic from the beginning was we're all in a storm. Not all of us are in the same boat, but we're all in a storm. And what becomes clearer is that what the pandemic highlights are all the multiple storms. And I think we all know that the last few weeks in South Africa have maybe really highlighted the challenges that have always been there, and that we have to really dig deep to survive these storms and to keep our heads above water. So you all know this, and I don't want to traumatize anybody further, but I think it's really important when we talk about dealing with feelings and coping that we face things head on, but with courage. And I'm going to talk more about that in a moment. So I found these images in the last week. So two of them we know are from what happened in our country with the looting, with the large scale kind of insurrection, whatever the desperation, the complexities. But we know that we're not alone in suffering in the world. I want to remind you that in Eswatini, there's a great deal of social and political strife at the moment. The top right-hand corner of my image is actually an image from Trafalgar Square outside the British Museum, I think. But it's after the Euro Cup final loss where England lost, and in a kind of racist, hysterical mob display, this is what happened in London just 2 weeks ago itself. And of course, we know that there's been large-scale flooding in China, in Western Europe. This is an image from Germany from 2 weeks ago as well. Things are hard. The truth is, things have always been hard. My husband, who's an English teacher, will often say when people complain and when I complain about the world, he says, can you imagine what it was like to be a 14-year-old boy living in rural England, knowing you would be conscripted in 1914 into World War I? And I'm going to come back to World War I in a moment, interestingly. So life is hard, and we know that. And none of us, no matter who we are, is separate from the global realities that we face. There are multiple challenges to us all around privilege, systemic racism, class and gender inequality, climate change, resource allocation, the recessions that we face as a world. We're not separate from that. And I know there's been a lot of kind of talk on South African social media about we are South Africans and we are resilient. Of course we are resilient, but all human beings have the capacity for resilience. It's not something that only South Africans have. So part of what makes it difficult to face all this complexity is we don't know who the adults are in the room. So when we're little, we think that our parents or our caregivers, or we have a fantasy that the adults in charge of the world maybe know what they're doing. We might think there are bad adults, but we always often had the fantasy that there were good adults who could know what was going on. But what we see, and I think what the last decade has shown, both globally in terms of politics, but certainly what the coronavirus pandemic has shown is that we don't know who the adults are in the room. We don't know what the truth is. There is so much there's an overload of information. One of the terms I started seeing last year was the idea of the infodemic, that there's too much information. It's an overwhelming load for people, and especially those of you who are parents to young children and teens, they too are flooded with information because of access to social media. And of course, there's a lack of consensus. There's a lack of consensus about how best to fix the world, how best to live in the world, whether you should get a vaccine or not. I hope nobody here thinks they shouldn't get a vaccine. But anyway, I won't go into that at this moment. But there's a lot of controversy, a lot of fake news. The tendency towards kind of histrionic, paranoid fake news. It's not that fake news is neutral in itself, but it creates more negative feeling. And I will talk a little bit later about how negative feelings are really, really catchy. And so it's life, but as Mr. Spock says in Star Trek, not as we know it. And I'm sure some of you see how when you watch like a Netflix show or TV show and somebody blows out the candles on a birthday cake, you get this like feeling of, oh, they're spreading their virus. And the world has changed in terms of the way we connect. And the difficulties we face, whether you've at the extreme of having lost someone close to you or your job or the realities, or even if it's just that you're sitting in the middle anticipating losses, the difficulties and challenges are real and not imagined. If any of you have not felt any of these feelings at some point in the last year, I don't think you're really human. But if you haven't felt any of these feelings, I'd love you to be in contact with me and let me know what your secret is. But I think many of us have felt grief, fear, anxiety. We've experienced losses. We've felt a sense of loss, uncertainty, irritability, anger, frustration, exhaustion, boredom, emptiness, hopelessness, helplessness, depression, all of those things. There's a term that's come out of the pandemic. It's an old term, but that people are talking about is that what people often experience is a sense of languishing, that we're not getting anywhere. The world isn't improving. We aren't improving. And that is why it's so important to focus on some of the things I'm going to talk about this morning. We all face change and transition. I mean, it's a given of being human is that life changes and we move between states. But particularly, whether it's the transitions to online learning, online schooling, crisis schooling, masking, being at home, being allowed to walk in parks, whatever it is, we face huge transition. And there is the possibility out of all of this difficulty that there's something, and trauma experts have really been working on this. There's an area of trauma work that looks at what happens after a trauma. We all know about PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder, but there's another phenomenon called post-traumatic growth. Now, post-traumatic growth is the best possible outcome of difficult times, but I want to reinforce that it's not inevitable. It's hard won. It's not like if you just have the right attitude, you will have post-traumatic growth and learn and move on. It's hard and it's difficult. And that's what I want to really emphasize is all of this takes intentional practice that and sometimes also luck. So post-traumatic growth is something I'm going to talk a bit about. I said I'd mention World War I again, and that one of my favorite quotes is from Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings. And some of you may have seen the movie or read the books, depending on how nerdy you were as a teenager. But it's what is important is that Tolkien wrote this novel, the set of novels after World War I, where he was very, very impacted by two things, was the scale of devastation of the battlefields of World War I, which we know was one of the probably most brutal wars where many, many, many people lost their lives. And he was aware of this devastation, which gave him a sense of like, what is the struggle for good and evil? And he located it in Middle Earth. And the protagonist, the hero of this movie, novel, Frodo, says to his mentor and guide, I wish it need not have happened in my time. So do I, said Gandalf, and so do all who live to see such times. But that is not for them to decide. All we have to decide is what to do with the time that is given us. None of us have a choice about the time we live in, but we have a choice about how to cope with that and what to do with it. So having thought about that, maybe this is a space, we're going to start with some practical things, that when you're faced with difficult feelings and difficult experiences, it's important to be prepared in the same way as if you're going on a road trip. Before you set out on the road trip, make sure you have a spare tire, make sure you have petrol in your car. When you're facing life as a grown-up, knowing that you are the grown-up in the room, you have to be responsible for your life and for your well-being, for your thriving. You need to prepare. And one of the ways we can prepare is to put into place practices that allow you to calm yourself down, regulate yourself, pause, ground yourself in the reality to give you the energy and focus to move on. So one of the strategies, there are many of these, you can download activities via the internet, self-compassion visualizations, self-compassion exercises. But one of the things I encourage people to do is to imagine your safe place, wherever that might be. I've given you some images, which are really beautiful, and I'd love to be at any of those. But it might be in your bed. It might be in a cozy a TV room that you love sitting in. It may be a place you visited on a holiday in your childhood, or a place you wish you could go to. Even if there isn't a place you can imagine, it's useful to generate some idea of a safe place, and even print out a picture of that, put it as your screensaver. And when I come to some of the more practical strategies for managing difficult feelings, I'd like you to go back to that place. But also, I'd like you to all remember that it sounds so utterly corny, but just breathing properly can go a long way to helping you cope with even the most difficult situations. And the most simple of all breathing activities involves asking you to just breathe in through your nostrils, unless you have a very bad cold. Breathe in for a count of three, and then out for a count of three. The people who do a lot of breath work will call this coherent breathing, but all it is a slower, more deliberate form of breathing that is absolutely sure to calm you down and ground you so you can face the world. And one of the strategies, the breathing, the coherent breathing, the recommendation is that you practice it every day for 3 minutes twice a day. It's quite a long time to be breathing, but you can do it sort of while you're brushing your teeth, when you get into bed at night. So practice that breathing technique. It's very important that you count when you breathe, in for a count of three and out for a count of three. So hold that in mind, and we're going to go through some of the theory of why it's important to think about feelings and emotions. So what is going to help us in the world, apart from your breathing and your safe place, is to have a fact-based approach. I've always been interested, and John knows this, your dean, that in an effectful approach, that when, and the work of Hans Rosling, who was a Swedish public health expert, he worked with the World Bank, with the United Nations, with world leaders. And what he found was that world leaders, top people who are making important policy decisions about how money would be spent, about how programs would roll out, about which policies would be made law, they often would make these decisions with a very inaccurate sense of what the world was really like. In fact, he argued that they would have a much more negative view of the world than was necessary. So for any of you who are interested in that work, and I think anybody who is making policy, who's deciding on how to spend money in the world, who's wanting to think about the world in a non-hysterical way, is to go and look at his work. Hans Rosling, he has died, but his work has been carried on by his son and daughter-in-law. So I encourage you all to have a fact-based approach to the world and to your feelings. We need to tolerate uncertainty, which is easier said than done, but practice and intention and thoughtfulness will help you do that. We need to work at building relational trust, whether that's between the people in our close circles, our families, our friends, and certainly in our workplaces, and as the last few weeks have just highlighted again and again, we need to build that within our country and between countries as well. We need some tools to manage stress, and we need to get some perspective and start thinking about the whys of our life. So why think about feelings? Now, feelings, of course, are the conscious experience of emotional reactions. Theorists and researchers in psychology and will say emotions can be very unconscious. They can have a strong physiological component. When I'm talking this morning, I'm talking very broadly, and I'm going to talk about feelings and emotions as though they're very similar, as though they are the same thing, because in practice, we have to deal with them in similar ways. Why think about them is our emotions, our physiological states, and our feelings influence the way we think. It influences what we see, what we perceive, how we attend to things, what we attend to, what we learn and how we learn, memory, that your capacity to remember what you've learned or what has even happened to you is shaped by your emotions. It affects our reasoning. We often think that reasoning is separate from emotion. It's absolutely not. And it affects our problem solving. Our feelings motivate our actions and behaviors, but they also are both the driver of our experiences, but also the expression of what's happened to us. The thing about feelings is they're often not what they seem to be. And that's really often the work in psychotherapy, is helping people tease out why they're feeling what they're feeling. Sometimes it's hard to even name what you're feeling or know what you're feeling until you've really thought it through or talked it through. And sometimes people don't always know why they're feeling what they're feeling. They don't know why they're in an anxious state until they've really taken time to look at the causes or the trigger events. And we know that difficult feelings evoke defensive, harmful responses, and as I've said, can block thinking. What's very important is we all as humans can confuse feelings and facts. And it's really important to remember that our feelings are important, but they're not facts. So I'm going to start with a little movie. Those of you with young children or those of you who are very young yourselves may have seen this movie. And if you haven't, I still recommend it. It's a great movie that is based on neuroscience. The people who wrote this animated movie that comes out of Pixar Studios, it's called Inside Out, really looked, they went to the psychologists and the neuroscientists to say, how does the self develop and what are feelings like? So this is a metaphor about the beginnings of feelings. And I hope you enjoy this little clip.
From there.
Very nice. Okay, looks like you got this. Very good. Well,
that's her look out!
That's fear. He's really good at keeping Riley safe.
Easy, easy, huh? I'm back! Oh, we're good. We're good.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And we're back.
Here we go. All right, open.
This looks new.
Think it's safe?
What is it? Okay, caution. There is a dangerous smell, people. Hold on, what is that?
This is disgust. She basically keeps Riley from being poisoned, physically and socially.
That is not brightly colored or shaped like a dinosaur. Hold on, guys. It's broccoli! Yeah! Well, I just saved our lives. Yeah, you're welcome.
Riley, if you don't eat your dinner, you're not gonna get any dessert.
Wait, did he just say we couldn't have dessert?
That's anger. Cares very deeply about things being fair.
So that's how you want to play it, old man? No dessert? Oh, sure. We'll eat our dinner right after you eat this.
Right. Here comes an airplane.
Oh, airplane. We got an airplane, everybody. Airplane.
And you've met Sadness. She, well, she... I'm not actually sure what she does. And I've checked, there's no place for her to go. So she's good, we're good, it's all great. Anyway, these are Riley's memories and they're mostly happy, you'll notice, not to brag. But the really important ones are over here. I don't want to get too technical, but these are called core memories. Each one came from a super important time in Riley's life.
So if you want to see what happens to Riley, you'll have to watch Inside Out. But that is how we know that children are born, infants with a capacity for basic emotions. We saw their joy, sadness, fear, disgust, anger, and surprise is another. There are a few that psychologists and researchers debate about which are the core feelings, but our core feelings have their origins both genetically, prenatally, and physiologically. Our bodies and our feelings are not separate. So they have their origins in those early days. And I've mentioned the basic affects or basic feelings. And our feelings are also shaped by the experiences of people before us. And there's a fascinating field of research into what is called the epigenetics, not just of, so epigenetics is about which of our genes get switched on or not. And what researchers are telling us is that the experiences of previous generations, our grandparents, our great-grandparents, shape even our epigenetics. So we are shaped by traumas that have happened to previous generations. And it's really important to hold that in mind. And that's why we understand that things are not simple. If any of you are interested in this, there's a new book out by Oprah Winfrey and Bruce Perry. Bruce is a trauma specialist and it's called What Happened to You? And they speak really clearly and lucidly about this intergenerational transmission of trauma and about the impact of trauma on the growing person. Our developmental experiences, like Riley, whether we have experiences of being well cared for or experiences of emotional or physical neglect or abuse or trauma. Of course, gender socialization plays a huge role in how we experience our feelings and how we are allowed to express them. So, for example, boys are told that it's not okay to cry. We're told that big boys don't cry, you know, get up and dust yourself off. And girls are told that often, typically not, and I'm hoping we're moving away from this, but that, for example, being angry is ugly. So women learn to mask their anger and mask their assertiveness. And men and boys learn to mask or hide their vulnerabilities or their sadnesses. So culture also shapes what feelings are acceptable and how we express them. And as I mentioned, there are obviously individual triggers. So what will trigger you or push you to feel something will be different for everybody else in the world. And as I've mentioned also that emotions are contagious. I mean, it's a bit corny, this little coronavirus image, but it's catchy. And negativity is particularly catchy. But then we also need to remember, and I think that, and I'll come back to this a bit later, but that hope is also contagious. And when we saw the Rebuild South Africa kind of initiatives, I think a lot of people caught a little bit of relief and hope after a very, very difficult week. So I've mentioned that our feelings shape our thinking, but that our thinking reinforces or strengthens certain feelings. And the cognitive behavior therapist will talk about this as the cognitive distortions that can make our feelings feel more difficult often. And some of the things we do as humans is we catastrophize. We tend to see the worst possible outcome of any situation. We mind read. We think we know what other people are feeling. We think, I can't go and speak to my manager about this because he'll never agree to it. I know she's angry with me because we make assumptions about why people are feeling what they're feeling. We also engage in fortune telling. We say, oh, that will never work. And then that stops us trying. It stops us hoping. It stops us coping. One of the things we all do is, especially under stress, is we use all or nothing thinking. And we think that things are either all good or all bad. And what that makes us do is we can minimize what is good and magnify what is bad. Of course, we can also do the opposite. So we can be an Eeyore and only see what's negative, but we can also be a Pollyanna. And this is really dates me that I saw the movie and read the books. But Pollyanna was a little girl who could only see the bright side of everything. It's really, really an irritating way to live your life and really irritating to be around someone who's always telling you to look on the bright side of something terrible. So Pollyannas can be a problem. And the truth is that despite your best efforts, sometimes life is just hard, and that's okay. That's just real. And if any of you are interested, one of my favorite websites is a website called despair.com. And despair.com is the site and the home of demotivational posters. And I love them because motivational posters can sometimes make you feel so enraged with their Pollyanna. If you just are good enough, brave enough, try hard enough, everything will be okay. And I love this picture of the lava from some volcano creeping across the road and reminding us that some obstacles cannot be overcome with determination and a positive attitude. And much as having a relentlessly negative attitude is so toxic for your body and so bad for yourself and your community, relentless kind of overwhelming optimism is really a form of denial, and that's not helpful either. So what is really important is to remember that we are all humans. Now, I'm not going to depress you with this because this is not depressing. This is just real. The existentialist philosophers and psychologists talk about the tragic triad of human existence, that whether you like it or not, this is what we all face. We all face pain and suffering, guilt, and death. At different times in our lives, we are able to put that aside more often than not. What COVID has meant is that this is in our faces. We cannot deny it. So given that this is inevitable and inescapable, I'm going to also argue that it's really important to face, that actually it will help us to not be in a state of utter denial. Some of you may remember the REM song, Everybody Hurts. And the truth is, everybody hurts sometimes. Pain and loss is inevitable, inescapable, and it's important to accept and expect difficult feelings. If you think that having difficult feelings means that somehow you're failing, get that out of your head. You are being human when you have difficult feelings. We all flip our lids. I'll come back to that a bit later. And everybody hurts sometimes. So one of the things that happens is when we have difficult feelings, we can, because they are so uncomfortable and because we've been socialized not to have them, and because we're told that they're weakness or they're evidence of a problem, people go to great lengths. We all do go to great lengths to avoid them. We can suppress our emotions, deny that we have them. We can internalize. Some of us, because of who we are in the world, because of our experiences, we may be more prone to internalizing. And that manifests typically in things like withdrawal, emotional blunting, avoidance of what is difficult, somatization, which is the bodily expression of difficult feelings. So having a pain or illness, stomach aches are typical ones, headaches. Those are often the expression of psychological difficulties, nightmares, obsessive intrusive thoughts, magical thinking, wishing, like unrealistic wishing for things, jitteriness, fatigue, lethargy are all forms of internalizing rather than processing, managing difficult feelings. We also, people often have externalizing strategies for managing difficult feelings, meltdowns, irritability, road rage is a typical meltdown, physical aggression, oppositionality, defiance. And we see, those of you with children, I don't know what that happened, is that also self-medicating and self-harm are strategies that people use to manage difficult feelings, substances, alcohol, over-the-counter pills, excessive risk-taking. It's not me who's drawing on the screen. I don't know who is, but anyway, thanks for the annotations. But just to make a point, and if any of you are interested in this, the link between difficult feelings, trauma, and how people cope with them, I also want to point you to the work of Gabor Mate. It's spelled M-A-T-E, his surname. He's a Canadian physician, and he's written a book called When the Body Says No. But he makes the point that addiction, substance use, is not the problem. Substance use or addiction is a solution to a problem. It's not a great solution. It's a harmful way to manage a difficult situation. But he says the underlying problem is unmanaged trauma, unmanaged difficult feelings, and a disconnection between people and between people. There's a lack of relational trust. So I like that way that he depathologizes the way we cope with feelings, because we're all human, but helps us see that there are more productive ways of coping with difficult feelings. Brené Brown says that truth and I'm very jealous of Brené Brown because she's just fabulous. And I'm sure many of you have seen her TED Talks and her podcasts and her audiobooks and her books, but she's written a lot about vulnerability and shame. And she makes the point that especially people like yourselves who are high functioning graduates, studying, working, having jobs, managing other people, especially those people find vulnerability very, very difficult because it exposes us in ways we find shameful. We are ashamed of our vulnerabilities. We're ashamed of our imperfections. We're ashamed of the things we don't cope with. And the more ashamed we are and the more vulnerable we feel, the more we use dysfunctional strategies to cope with them. And being able to adapt to change, I know it's a big buzzword, agile, being able to just move between and cope with new situation means you have to be comfortable with imperfection, failure, and vulnerability. You have to be able to fail big sometimes and recover. We have to be able to tolerate imperfection without shame, face our flaws without being afraid, own our mistakes, our blind spots, and our limitations with courage and openness. And Brené Brown says that truth and courage aren't comfortable, but they're never weakness. So the benefits of difficult feelings are they provide insight into our inner and outer worlds in ways that help us connect authentically with other people, avoid danger. So if you understand what you're feeling and why, you can make better decisions about the world. It helps us recover from loss and hopefully find meaning. There's some research that people who experience what is called emo diversity, which is the rich array of both positive and negative emotions, have better mental health than people who only try and be positive all the time or who are mired in a kind of negativity. So the challenge is to mindfully embrace rather than suppress tough emotions. And I found this quote from the book Dune by Frank Herbert. It's a science fiction book. And he makes the point, the main character who's really in the worst of all worlds. And he says, I must not fear. Fear is the mind killer. Fear is the little death that brings total obliteration. I will face my fear. I will permit it to pass over me and through me. And when it is gone, only I will remain. Sorry, I can't see my screen so well. I will turn the inner eye to see its path. Where the fear has gone, there will be nothing. Only I will remain. So what he's saying is that in order to come to overcome fear, you have to be able, sorry, someone's unmuted themselves. Again. So fear is, so in order to cope with it, you have to face it. You can't walk away from it. You have to allow the fear to be part of you, own it. And when it's gone, there you are, richer for it, stronger for it. So what are these practical strategies that can help you face fear, grief, helplessness, whatever the difficult feelings are? Now, of course, you need to be real about what is possible. All of us think that when we've got lots of time, like lockdowns, we are going to do all these amazing self-help strategies and classes. And I love this meme about took a yoga class to help my stress levels. Now I'm stressed about where yoga will fit in my day. Do what is possible. And what is really important is you don't have to make huge changes to your life to make your life better. When you're coping with difficult feelings, very, very small activities, like 3 minutes a day of breathing, might be enough to restart or to just get you back on a healthier path. Often what especially type A achievement-oriented people do is they start on their self-help programs in absolutely like full-on ways, and then that can't be sustained. Be real about what is possible. Just focus on the next right thing to do. When things are really difficult, especially if you're in the midst of a trauma, this is an idea that comes out of Alcoholics Anonymous also, is when you've been coping with difficult feelings in a harmful way, it can feel overwhelming to think you can never use that strategy again. You can never have another drink. You can never have another hit of what it is you are using. That can feel so overwhelming. And that's why those kind of 12-step programs or recovery programs focus on just for today. Don't worry about tomorrow. One day at a time. And that's the idea of when you're in a terrible situation, don't worry about next week or about the project that's due next month. What is it you need to do in the next moment to ground yourself, to calm yourself down, and to brace yourself to be able to face what is difficult? So what is the next right thing to do? And I'm going to give you a list of some really practical next right things you can do. And as I've said, prepare in advance. Go through these ideas. I'm very happy to share my slides and that you can all have access to them. So don't worry about making notes. But a thing to understand when you're thinking about the next right thing is to understand that we can really crudely think of our brains as operating on two different levels, an upstairs level and a downstairs level. So our downstairs brains, absolutely crudely speaking, and for those of you who have a background in medicine or in biology, you'll know how simplistic this is, but our downstairs brains, the parts of the brain that are highlighted in red and yellow, are the survival parts of the brain. The red part, the reptilian brain, or the midbrain structures, are responsible for basic survival and basic functions like breathing, alertness, arousal. If you've ever had a concussion, it's because there's swelling on those midbrain structures. And that part of the brain is very sensitive to cues from the external world, from our senses, around a physical survival. So it responds to threat at a physical level, somebody running at you, a movement in the grass, a sound of that alerts you. That and if we know that the responses to this are fight, flight, freeze, submit, there are a number of responses. Flocking is another response where we turn to other people to look at what is their response. You know, children from tiny will look at their parents' face to see how should they respond to danger. So often a child, when there's something's happened, before the child responds, before they cry even, they will often look back at a caregiver's face for a signal, for evidence of, is this a safe situation? And that's why I can tell you without doubt, children cope in relation to how their parents are coping. If parents are coping and managing things, then children cope that much better. Our emotional brain or our limbic system deals with threats and survival and emotions, but it responds to threats at a psychological level. So at a psychological level, the submit might not be like animals do to lie on the ground and show your throat, but the submission might be to say, no, no, you're right. I don't want to argue anymore. Let it go. Let's move on. The freeze might not be that you physically stand frozen, while the charging sort of white rhinos coming across, but the white rhinos are not aggressive, but when there's a charging animal for you. But the freeze response at an emotional level might be that when you've got an angry person shouting at you, you literally cannot find words. Your mouth dries up. You cannot think. And that's often why if you're in a conflict situation at work, you can't always resolve it in the moment because you're in a state of fight, flight, freeze, or submit. And we know that's probably what happened with many of the people caught up with the looting, et cetera, is that they were in states of like kind of not thinking out of their downstairs brains, which are very primed to deal with survival. But it also means that those are not the parts of the brain that are managed, that have access to an awareness of time or to an awareness of language. The language centers of our brain are located in our neocortex, in the top part of our brain and the front part, so behind our foreheads and the top part of our brain. And those are the last parts of the brain to mature. The brain develops from the inside out and from the downstairs up. So the frontal lobes of the brain only mature about the time you are 25. So those of you with teenagers have a long path to walk with them. The frontal lobes are the executive of the brain. They are the chief executive officers, the managing directors. They are the centers of logic, impulse, control, reasoning, language. And we use that part of the brain, the neocortex or the rational brain or the executive brain, to manage the difficult feelings we have. And Daniel Siegel, who's a psychiatrist, speaks about this, whether it's with children or with ourselves, is that when we are under pressure, when we feel under threat emotionally or physically, when we are in a state of heightened emotionality, one of the things that can happen is we can literally flip our lids, that we can stop using our frontal lobes and our upstairs brains to manage those difficult feelings. And then we respond in this physical fight, flight, freeze, submit, whatever strategy is natural to us, or whichever strategy is that we've been sort of socialized into. And the challenge is when you are not using your upstairs brain, you are not making good choices. And what happens then is we don't use helpful ways to manage feelings. So the challenge as adults and to work with it, whether you as a parent working with your kids, as a caregiver, or as a manager working with your employees who might be in a difficult state, is to help people engage their thinking capacities to manage their difficult feelings. And some of those strategies are pausing, slowing down, so that you can step back to think and not simply react. Paying close attention to what's really going on inside of you. What are the feelings that are happening? Regulating yourself. And we talk about when you're in a state of heightened emotionality, to regulate yourself to a healthy level, to down-regulate yourself if you're very, very over-aroused, or to up-regulate yourself if you've really withdrawn and slumped, using things like your safe place or your breathing and engaging your upstairs brain. Connection is a very, very helpful way to manage feelings. And that's part of the flocking survival response, where we look to others for connection. But connection helps us, it gives us a space to talk through feelings, to feel less alone, to feel witnessed and understood. It's a very, very powerful human experience. And one of the things Daniel Siegel speaks about is naming feelings in order to claim them and tame them. So it's name, claim, and tame. When you name a feeling, it makes it less intense. There's huge power in naming and understanding. Whether you put it into words by talking with a therapist or a counselor or a friend or writing in a journal, being able to name what you're feeling allows you to claim the feeling, to face it with that courage, to have the courage to own the feeling, and make the links between your feelings and their origins, and then tame the feeling, to have the feeling and not let the feeling have you. And that's a way we get unstuck. I've also sometimes talked about it as you name it, feel it, let it go. If you've got a difficult feeling, like name it and own it, feel it, know that it was there, and let it go. Walk forward and move forward with intentionality and courage. And these are some of the practical ideas that we've been using with the Healthcare Workers Network, These are the kinds of things that we can recommend to a doctor who's been working in an ICU, who may only have 30 seconds while they're walking from one ICU to the bathroom or between two wards, or a nurse who's maybe only got 3 minutes to, you know, have a break. These are strategies that they have found useful, so I want to really recommend that you use these strategies. If you only have 30 seconds available to you, there are quick fix emergency actions you can do. If you suddenly feel panicky, scared, enraged, unable to cope. And the first is, as I mentioned, to breathe, do the coherent breathing. You can do things, a lot of these strategies are about pausing, calming yourself down, focusing yourself in the moment. So for example, taking a few sips of really, really cold water, or sitting in a chair and closing your eyes and thinking about what are all the things I can hear in the next 30 seconds, just distracting yourself and focusing on something outside of yourself. Pick up a special photo or object that evokes happy memories and focus on what it means to you. Put it as a screensaver, have it on your desk, put it on the wall that you're facing every day in your work from home office, wherever it is. Learn a favorite inspiring quote, whether it's something from a poem, a song, a Bible verse, a religious teaching, whatever that is meaningful for you, say it to yourself. And I love this idea that you can just think of two things that are just about okay. They don't have to be perfect or brilliant, but when you're feeling overwhelmed, think about two things that are just about okay. That's all it takes. If you have the luxury of 3 minutes, do something like go get a Sheldon Cooper in Big Bang Theory always offers people who are distressed a warm beverage. He's learned that holding a warm drink in your hands, especially on a cold day, can really calm you down. There's even evidence that it, because there's a vasodilation, it is actually physiologically, it's good for you to hold something warm in your hands and have a sip of something comforting. Listen to a favorite piece of music. If you're very, very distressed and worked up and anxious, even something like going to brush your teeth or wash your face, even if you don't need to, can just refocus you. I'm a big believer in encouraging people to write a worry list. Putting things down on paper can stop them going around ruminatively in your head. And I love that. Send someone a WhatsApp. Send them just a quick hello. Don't phone like your auntie who's going to keep you on the phone for 4 hours talking about all her problems. Just say, I just want to say hi. I'm thinking of you. I'm sending you love, sending you this cute picture. Connect, human connection. And if you're lucky enough to have 30 minutes to yourself, have a warm bath if you can. Watch a TV program, not hours and hours of binging, but half an hour of a fabulous TV program or YouTube videos, brilliant. Prepare something delicious and enjoy eating it. Get pleasure from your food. Sing something really loud. Put on music and dance loudly. Go outside and go for a walk. All of those kind of things, or get help if you need help. So I said, and just very briefly, I haven't got time to go into this for much longer because we're coming to an end, but that what's really important is Viktor Frankl, whose work was really powerful. He survived the concentration camps. He was a psychiatrist and neurologist. He said that we all are programmed. It's part of our basic instinct is to find meaning. And he quotes Nietzsche, who said, if we have a why, we can live with almost anyhow. Not anyhow, almost anyhow. There are some situations that are really, really difficult. But if you have a why, you can cope with almost anyhow. And he says that there are three sources of meaning: what we give to life, what we do, what we create, what we make, what we experience, what we take from life, and our attitude to things we can't change. So what we create is obvious. We all understand that what we give, who we look after, who we're raising, earning money to support a family, contributing to volunteer programs, to social programs that improve lives. What we contribute is meaningful and really important. What we do with our lives, what we create is really important. But as important, it's no less important, is there is meaning in what we take from our life. And Frankl called those the experiential values, what we experience. And he was very, very focused on uplifting experiences of all. Frankl was himself a mountain climber. He loved mountaineering, and he would get experiences of transcendence from the Alps, from being in the Alps. I mean, our country is beautiful. We have spaces to go to where we can really appreciate the beauty of nature. But it can be in a small way. It doesn't have to be on the top of some mountain path. Any uplifting experience is really meaningful. And if you are open and sensitive to what is genuine and beautiful, not in an aesthetic sense, but in a meaningful way, that gives you meaning in your life. Frankl said the greatest experiential value is love. And that is love in all its aspects, the love of other people, the love of our world, the love of our environment. And it's about connections, memory, and relationships, and the connection to the small world. And my favorite quote about this is from Ingmar Bergman. Sorry, spelling mistake there. Ingmar Bergman is a Swedish film director, and he made a movie set, I think it was set in the early part of the last century. And this is the quote, which I think applied especially to us last week. The world is a den of thieves and night is falling. Evil breaks its chains and runs through the world like a mad dog. No one escapes, not even our children. So it shall be. Therefore, let us be happy while we are happy. Let us be kind, generous, affectionate, and good. It is necessary and not at all shameful to take pleasure in the little world. Good food, gentle smiles, fruit trees in bloom, waltzes. So if we can all give ourselves permission to take pleasure in the little world, that will be meaningful. But there is suffering that is really difficult. If there is suffering that can be changed, if you're in a job you hate, if you are, if you can't walk and need a crutch, use a crutch. If you can leave the job that you hate, leave it. If you can take medication for your depression or go to therapy, get help, do that. Change what can be changed, but not everything can be changed. We can't bring back the people who have died. We can't, sometimes you're in a job that you can't leave. There are reasons that force you to stay. And Frankl said there's meaning in your attitude to coping with what can't be changed. And that's something really important to remember. It made me think, just to come to the end, is that what gave us meaning? So after a week of really tragedy, we saw people cleaning up. We saw people, the gift of the givers, donating food to anybody. We saw people rebuilding. We remembered that there are helpers. And that's a quote from Mr. Rogers, the American TV series, "In times of tragedy, look for the helpers." And of course, I even put in the bottom right-hand corner at the apology that was to the three Black footballers in the British football team who had this terrible racist kind of attack leveled against them after the British football. But there was this help. And I found this amazing poem by this British, by the Cape Town poet. She wrote the poem last week, Sunday. And she references Alan Paton's novel, Cry the Beloved Country. He describes this beautiful road, if any of you know it, I'm sure some of you do, this beautiful road between Richmond and Ikopo that is so beautiful, the green of those Natal landscapes. And he says, there is a road that runs that is lovely beyond any singing of it. And Fionnuala reminds us that the world is still lovely beyond all singing. After fire and plunder, another sound, bristles raking broken ground, amidst the trash and waste and weeping, the age-old fortitude of people sweeping. And there's something about the doing, the making it better. So what will really matter is psychological health, connection, and safety. That is what's going to get us through this time. Hope without illusion is the strategy we're going to need to get through this together. Mastery over what we can control, and being real about the limits of our powers and tolerating all our imperfections. Being kind and not judging yourself and not judging others. And being brave. And to end with this idea out of Japanese art, there's a form called kintsugi, which is the art of precious scars. So if you've made a beautiful ceramic bowl and it breaks, you can throw it away, or you can mend it, or you can mend it using gold lacquer. They put gold dust in the glue. And what comes out of this mending process is something unique and even more beautiful than before it was broken. Now, obviously, it's been scarred. We see the evidence of the scar. We see the rupture in the mending. But it is the art of precious scars. The scars come because of the process of growth. And Leonard Cohen, the songwriter, reminds us to ring the bells that still can ring, but to forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. There's a crack in everything. And that's what the world tells us. So when you're feeling strong, difficult emotions, remember your safe place, practice the pause, the naming, claiming, and taming, and self-compassion techniques. Stop, breathe, start again. Give yourself, insist that you give yourself permission to look after yourself. Put joy on your to-do list and look for your why. And that's where I'll stop for now. So I see that there's some comments and chat. I don't know if anyone would like to ask or... Yeah.
Yes, please ask questions, everyone. Thank you, Judith. That was just amazing. And so anyone who needs to go now, because we're a bit over time, then please feel just go. Those who need to stay can stay as long as Judith would wish to. But thank you for the extra time. So that was marvelous. Please ask questions.
Yeah. I see someone has, someone was saying running was the way to cope. I think it was Nalisa said. I mean, physical exercise has been so important. So I really want to say kudos to you. And the hard lockdown, yeah, we had to keep working, yeah, breathing. Yeah, you can do breathing, even if you couldn't. I mean, I was amazed by during the hard lockdown, how some people were doing these like little runs around their yards, like you'd have to do like 500 times around your yard, but amazing, yeah, so running. So I'm happy to send the slides. Thank you all someone said punching bag. I think not punching bag. That's interesting what my teenage son has got. And I think it's been very helpful. Although he's learned that there's a lot of technique to punching. It's not as simple as you think. And the principles of yoga, absolutely. I think someone said that's aligned to a lot of what I've said. Because I think what I've said in some ways is it's accessible to everyone. We all have this capacity to find this, but I really want to remind you, it's not easy. And you should never feel that you're weak or imperfect because you can't put everything into practice at once. It's something you want to keep working at and keep perfecting tiny little bits at a time. Yeah, breathing in, letting go. Ah, and Annalise, you said such lovely things. People want to listen to it again. I think the session has been recorded, so people can access it.
Well, actually, because there's that circle on it, I think because we'd like to keep a recording, I think we might do it again. There's so many other people who'd like to hear it. So open it up to our broader, you know, community as well.
Pleasure.
Thank you. So we'll do it again, if you can.
Yeah. Great. If anyone wants to raise their hand or a comment or just know that it's the weekend. And now, I don't know what you can do, but you can certainly in Joburg, although it's chilly, the sun is shining. Yeah. Always. Charles says, wants to say something. Maybe unmute yourself.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yeah.
Oh, okay, hello. I just want to say that was great. Thank you so much. And the one thing that I find that's really helpful that I do is I reach out to other people. So when we were going through this riots, I just started calling all my friends and saying, hey, are you okay? What's going on? And that takes the mind off of my own stress and my own worry by reaching out to other people. Awesome. Show somebody some love, man. And that's the best way to get through some pain.
Yeah. And I'd love to be able to do it with your amazing accent. That always makes me feel happy.
Oh, boy. Well, everybody down here has an amazing accent to me. So thank you so much. That was beautiful. Great way to start my Saturday morning. Actually, as you can see, I'm in the car on my way to the organic market now.
Wow. Enjoy.
All right. Thanks a
thank
lot.
Thank you.
Bye. Okay. Bye-bye.
Surami, you have your hand up. If you can just very quickly share with us what you'd like to say or question you'd like to ask.
All right. Good morning, everybody. Serami Muting with the site. Yeah, no, it was fruitful on my side to attend these sessions. I do have a quote from Anonymous just to share with everybody that says, your mind will quit 1,000 times prior your body. Well, feel fear and do it anyway. So simply means that we are capable of so much more than we believe. We tend to quit too early and we cease pushing ourselves just before we've reached the threshold of growth. And we allow fear keep us stuck in the same spot. So these sessions are very helpful on my side. So I want to thank everybody, Judy Ensa, Jonathan, Mamo, all the guys are very supportive on these sessions. And then thanks to Mr. Charles Anderson, our personal mastery facilitator. So we'll meet again on the 27th, where we'll be aligning with the SARS, the health and safety. I thank you, co-host. Thank you, Ensa.
That's amazing. Thank you. I loved your quote. Is anyone else? I think Ntabi Singh might have had her hand up. Or...
Morning. I lowered it down quickly, but happy to share. Thanks for this session, Judith. So let me see if I can have my video on. So thank you so much for this session. I think, as I mentioned at the beginning around expectations for me, was this was more personal for me than anything else. One of the things that I have recently learned, I think in the past 2 weeks, to do was to start being deliberately fair to myself. Because I had figured out that I'm one person that usually does a lot for everybody else, and I usually put myself last. And that had weighed a lot on me. And I started noticing that when I started feeling ill almost every day, and I didn't understand why, because I thought I ate healthy. I would do a couple of exercises a day because it's winter now, so it's not easy to go outside for me. And I had to do a very deliberate self-introspection to get to a point where I realized and I noted that I'm actually not putting myself first. And I started ensuring that I became fair. So if I'm not able to do something, I'm not able to do something. I won't do it at the expense of anything else that becomes on top of my priorities. So I thoroughly enjoyed this morning, Judith, a lot, because it also adds, I think, to what I've started doing recently in the past 2 weeks. So I'm really grateful for having been part of this session.
Can I just reinforce what you said? There's an idea that I often do when I train a lot of psychologists and psychiatrists, and I talk about the importance of not becoming a resentful caregiver. Because one of the things we often look, especially people who are good at looking after other people, we can really run out of steam and then we become resentful. And that's both toxic for ourselves and actually not helpful for the people that we're looking after. It's very boundaries. Limits are really important, not just to protect you, as you said, Ntabi Singh, but actually to protect other people. Because when you become resentful, you're kind of giving them poison porridge. You're not giving them like healthy stuff. So you have to look after yourself first, set the boundaries, set the limits. Becoming resentful is so toxic for us all. So well done to you. And that I like that intentional practice. Thank you. Yeah. Well, maybe, I don't know, people can go out and be with their families, be with their gardens or with their books or with their Netflix series. There's things to do.
Yeah. Or with their marking.
We are marking. Yeah. My husband's a high school teacher, so I know about marking. It never ends.
Never ends. Judith, thank you so much. It really was special, special, special. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Great. Thank you, Judith. That absolutely marvelous. Thank you, everyone, for coming, by the way. Thank you all for being here. Nothing is anything without the people who participate. So thank you so much. And Judith, that was really marvelous. And Mamo, thank you so much. And Graham also in the background for arranging this. You've done really well. I would really like us to do this again, if you're okay, and broaden. And I think on a regular basis do this work. So if you've got any more suggestions, and if you want to yourself contact Judith to do any work with you or anybody else, she's not allowed to advertise her, but I can. She'll probably kill me afterwards. But then you can find her on Judith, A-N-C-E-R, or let Mamo know, we'll find it. But we'll do more of these. And for me, thank you, Judith, for the great work.
Thank you. Stay well, everyone.
Thank you.
Stay sane.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Mamo.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Thank you, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much. Okay. Take care. See you soon.
Bye.
Yeah, bye. Bye-bye.